welcome to Performance Anxiety. KatieJane Garside's journey into music is a lot different than most. Unless, of course, you know another artist who spent their formative years sailing the world, spending literally years at sea. Then it turns out that she was discovered by legendary producer Glenn Johns. Her first productive band, Daisy Chainsaw, resulted in Courtney Love calling her one of the original Riot Grrrls. From Daisy Chainsaw through Queen Adrena, her music was unmistakable. And even when she met her longtime partner, Chris Whittingham, and changed gears to a quieter sound with Ruby Throat, it was just as intense. Now KatieJane and Chris have plugged back in with Liar Flower and combined those sounds into something really unique. Check out the new Liar Flower album, Geiger Counter, on One Little Indian. Follow her social media at GarsideKatieJane. Follow us at PerformanceANX. Subscribe, rate, review, share. I really want to make a terrible sailing pun right now, but I'll stop myself while you check out the show with KatieJane Garside of Liar Flower.
Yeah, now I've got performance anxiety. Okay, here it comes. All right, okay. Now, I am KatieJane Garside, and I am in a band called Liar Flower, and I've been in bands called Ruby Throat and Queen Adrena and Daisy Chainsaw, and you are listening to Performance Anxiety Podcast. I appreciate you.
Okay. No problem at all. So thank you for joining me. It's been really, really wild re-familiarizing myself with Daisy Chainsaw and getting to know Queen Adrena, Ruby Throat, and now Liar Flower, and your solo album that you, the KatieJane Garside album that you did.
What, Lalafari, wasn't it?
Yes.
Yeah.
But I want to know a little bit more about how you got to where you are before we actually get into the new album that's coming out.
Sure.
So, were you into music as a kid? I know, and we'll get into this a little bit, but I know you spent several of your formative years sailing, and even before that, were you in a musical household? Were you singing? Were you playing instruments?
Well, I remember my I don't know how it happened, but I think round about five, something like that, there was one of those suitcase record players.
Oh, yeah.
In the room that I shared with my sister. And there was just one record, and it was Petula Clark, Downtown.
Oh, wow. It's a great record to have.
Isn't it? Yeah, so a 7-inch single, and I just... I just remember just that, just playing that on repeat in our room. So as we played, I just adored it and just felt the thrill of it. It is still a really thrilling record, that one. If you listen to it, that chorus is just, there's a real euphoria in there.
Yeah. That's a perfect word. That's great.
And it's so, that was just, it was just, you know, it was, it, just, what's, I think there was like a transference of energy from that. To actually have that, it's making my heart race when I think about it. That's what it, that's what it made me feel, you know, just so exuberant, so exciting. And you could see all the lights, you know, because it talks about all the lights downtown. You could see all the lights in the music. And, that's my earliest memory.
So even at that young of an age, you really had a connection with music.
But it just really went, it's very, very much so. And my mum and dad, they got together really young and had us really young, and they just played everything from, you know, the Beatles and the Stones and, Cat Stevens and and Led Zeppelin and Elton John and and it was
all the good stuff.
And they part, you know, they were sort of kids, so they were just having so many parties and dinner parties, and music was all around.
And your father had a musical background, right? He played in some local bands, but he's also in the army, correct?
Yeah, my dad was in the SAS, and eventually he was in the SAS, but I think before that, yeah, he played trumpet, and he had to learn all the improvised bits note by note, because it didn't. The so-called improvised bits, no, because it didn't come naturally. So he learned them note by note by note, and decided that wasn't for him. So he became the singer what I'd do to have some recordings of that. Hey?
Oh yeah, I imagine.
Yeah, but that was it. My sister, she's 4 years younger than me, and she sort of has a kind of savant touch, where she was writing songs on piano at 3 years old. And
oh wow!
Just completely self-taught, and I'm not that. That's not where I come from. I think I feel it in my body, you know. I see it in right. pictures, and I never played an instrument, not till I was where I am now, which is 51. I started playing I can't even claim it, actually. I play auto harp, but you know, I still play it like a kid with a paint pot, you know, so and I love it so much, you know. It's like, you know, learning all the time, it's broken my brain open and given me access to a whole other thing that I didn't know I had. So yeah, it's
that's amazing. Hmm. Now, when you were 12, you and your whole family lived aboard a yacht for 4 years and sailed the world. How did that happen? Why did that happen? And how did that have an effect on you?
Well, it just, you know, these guys that I came from, they're sort of very romantic, and they just dream it up and they do it. And
wow.
My dad I remember he was talking to me one day when I was in the bath, and he said, "Do you want to sail around the world?" And I said, I think I was about 7 years old, and I was just like, okay, daddy, as long as we can call the boat Silver Seaweed, I'm up for it.
That was the only condition.
Yeah, it was my only condition. Took us a few years. I was 11 actually when we left, and that was a 2 year. I was soon 12. You're right. That was a 2 year circumnavigation.
Wow.
A lot of time spent at sea, and absolutely no comms, no communication devices, no radio, not even VHF radio, nothing.
Oh my God.
Nothing to the outside world. On a very small boat, 32-foot boat. And
wow.
Yeah.
That's amazing. That must have really given you a different perspective on life and the world.
Well, I think that's so formative. I can't underestimate it, because at that age, we would spend over a month at sea at various points. We spent a lot of time at sea. To get around the world in 2 years means you're covering on a relatively slow boat. You know, these boats, they don't. You're happy if you're going five knots.
Wow.
You know, that's not much faster than walking. So, you know, that's a long time at sea. And yeah. I was very fortunate to have my little sister, Mel. And we, you know, we literally had books and ourselves and the toys we made. You know, I made rag dolls, and we would spend hours and hours just acting out stories, listening to wobbly old tapes that my grandfather had made for us of all the great musicals like West Side Story and My Fair Lady and...
Oh, wow.
And Carousel, and we'd never seen the movies or the screenplay, so we just made it, you know, made up all these mad stories with our dolls. And
oh my gosh.
And that was our intensive education for 2 years, as well as, you know, encountering sort of horrendous weather conditions and tiny pieces of paradise on desert islands and things like
that.
Oh
my gosh.
Yeah, so it's a life of high contrast and self-reliability, you know, relying on self but I think that really sets off like fireworks in the synapses and the child finds herself, you know.
Yeah, because you know you're isolated for weeks, months at a time, and you know if you don't start doing something, you'll go crazy. And you know you had those tapes, and is that when you really started singing and singing along with those tapes that your grandfather made?
You know, that came earlier. Actually, I did. I found okay. I just found that I loved to sing, and I always did, and I found that it gave me a deep sense of peace and all rightness with the world. And yeah. I always did that I'm not sure what the word is I'm looking for. To comfort yourself, to make yourself okay. Right with the world. Nowadays, I call it like an altered state or even meditation or a trance state. But, you know, as a kid, that's okay. Not how you think about it. So, yeah, just made things right with the world. And I remember doing, you know, putting on plays with all my beloved cousins and my sister at Christmas and all that kind of thing. And I remember hearing my dad's sister, my aunt, just saying as an aside to someone, she can really sing. And
wow.
And I took that, I drank that, I went, okay, that's for me. And I never let go of that one comment. And that was my way in there.
That was when you really decided you wanted to make music professionally then, at when your aunt told you, you overheard your aunt talking about you.
Well, I just knew that it was mine. I didn't think beyond that, but I just knew that this was mine. And that was a moment of outside validation that made it, it validated that.
Okay.
And I just, you know, it still does, you know, I do that.
Yeah.
It's a huge, and I hear my daughter doing it too, because we just, I, if I'm not talking and I don't talk very much, I'm singing or just, you know, just making it up as I go along, whatever I do. And, my daughter does the same thing. As one of her greatest joys for me is to just hear her in her little world, just, you know, singing away there is really, really beautiful.
So you're doing the exact opposite of what your father did then. So, you're a lot of your music has been improvised, whereas your dad was practicing the stuff that was improvised.
Well, it's funny, isn't it? Because with all that kind of thing, you have to practice so really hard to be able to improvise. So, you know, it's that old thing, and I don't make any claim to any height or depth of knowledge or accomplishment in any of this. But, you know, it's that, I think it's a Picasso quote of... you have to practice until you can draw like a child. You know, there's something You have, you have to know your craft to be able to let go of it. And so it has. You have to be steeped in the craft, in a sense. And my craft is very, very haphazard. You know, it's a bit of a, it's a car crash of a craft. Yeah. But I am, I was steeped in it. And now I can, I am steeped in it. So I can let it go and let the song write itself, if you see what I mean.
When did you start playing in bands? You guys finally stopped sailing and you started your own life at some point. Was Daisy Chainsaw your first real band, or were there other bands before that?
Well, something strange happened. And I made a tape of, I was singing, absolutely loved the Rumours album, Fleetwood Mac. I just, again, that was my, you know, my mum and dad just played that relentlessly. And I made a tape, you know, on an old ghetto, you know, whatever, boombox thing where you have, they used to have two cassette things on them.
Yes, yeah, I remember this.
I would play Dreams with Stevie singing, and then I would sing along with Stevie and record it onto the other tape on that thing.
Oh, wow.
And I did that just carefully, sort of trying to make my voice the most dominant voice, you know, with miking it up. And my sister had it, and she was playing it. Oh, goodness. She was at boarding school when we came back from the sea, because my dad had to make some money. We came home with like £50 and a boat.
Oh, wow.
So he'd gone overseas to make money. And in the meantime, Mel got sent to boarding school. And I'm sort of a bit ashamed of this, but I refused to go, so my mother couldn't join him out there overseas. But anyway, she was at boarding school, and she took the tape to school with her, and she was playing it one day in the dormitory, and somebody walked in and heard the tape and went, who's that singing? And it was me, and he asked if he could have the tape, and she gave it to him. And he called me and asked me if I wanted to be in his son, if I would consider singing in his son's band.
Wow.
Now, that guy was Glyn Johns, and his son was Ethan Johns. And so Ethan and I messed around for a year in Glyn's extraordinary studio, and
oh my gosh,
and made some atrocious recordings. But we were learning, you know, learning all the time, learning all the time. And then I think Ethan and I were going to go off to LA and become rock stars, and then it fell apart, as it should do when you're 16 years old.
Right.
So I quitted a scholarship I had at art college. So I suddenly there I was. I didn't have my band, and I didn't have my scholarship at art college, and I went to London, and I did some. I did some jobs, and I answered ads in the Melody Maker, and I didn't answer ads. I answered an ad. The first ad I answered was I met Crispin Gray.
And, wow.
And we set up Daisy Chainsaw. And that was a four-year adventure. And, so that was
adventures,
my win.
Yeah, adventure's definitely a word for it.
Yeah.
I've heard the music, and I've seen clips of the shows. I never, you know, unfortunately back then I never got a chance to see you guys, but those shows were wild. I mean, you threw yourself around.
Yeah.
It was, I mean, you gave everything you had on stage. It was amazing to watch.
Yeah. 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 Well, I found very early on that there's a switch that happens, and I'm, you know, that my see, most people in our business do, but I feel things really intensely, and the absolute horror of walking on stage, you know, that sense of sort of exposure and being on a precipice, just flicked a switch in me. So I found that very early on, and there you kind of, you know, if I had got out of my own way and stopped trying to try, I just had access to, let's say, we had access to a big let go.
As part of Daisy Chainsaw, you're on some incredible tours with bands, some of my favorite bands, like Mudhoney, yeah. Hole.
Yeah.
Courtney Love even called you one of the first true Riot girls. Those must have been amazing tours. Do you have any favorite moments or stories from touring with some of these really wild bands?
I'm sort of unfortunate in that, you know, my memory falls apart like the road behind me. It sort of just disappears. It just, you know, just like fractals on a screen.
Yeah.
Just disappears, yeah. Which is what keeps me making things, you know. So that's, but I did, I'm for me, Courtney Love, Force of Nature.
Yeah.
I adore her. I'm in awe of her. And
she of you, obviously.
She's so powerful. You know, there's such a power off that woman. And
oh, yeah.
And I just, you know, I can see it in my mind's eye of standing on, just on the side of the stage. It was actually at a gig. I was actually watching the gig. I was going to say I was side of stage, but I wasn't. I was in the audience, I think at Newport in Wales. It was a tiny, tiny crush gig, and absolutely the energy of everybody was so frenetic, and
yeah,
walls were melting, and I think Kurt came. He came to that gig because he talked to my bass player and told him he liked our single that was out at the time. But I just remember.
Oh, cool.
I never met Kurt, but just seeing her on stage, just seeing as she came on stage, phenomenal. The power, and I'm so grateful to have been there and shared all the grimy dressing rooms with her.
I have a question for you, and I'm not sure if this happened around this time or not, but I heard that Madonna tried unsuccessfully to sign you to her Maverick record label.
Yeah.
Can you tell me a little bit about that? Was that at that time period?
You know, I don't know how all the things fit together, so I can't really say. Crispin, who is the guitar player, he's got a much better kind of hold on the timeline. But she did ask us, and we were at a point where we were very clear on having as much artistic control as we wanted. And
right.
And, you know, who knows how that would have worked out. she maybe knew, but it seemed like suddenly it seemed a bit overwhelming. Like this was the big stuff where we would lose control or something like that. So
yeah,
and
yeah.
We were courting one little Indian at the time who we did in the end sign with, and who I work with today, even Derek Burkett. I've worked with him on and off my whole career.
Yeah.
And he, you know, continues to give me as much artistic freedom as I want. So we did turn that down, and it's just one of those things.
So you left Daisy Chainsaw 93, and several years later, from Queen Adrena, which is another really, a band that can be pretty heavy and bombastic. And then moving on, fast forwarding a little bit, you met Chris Whittingham.
Yeah.
While he was busking, and formed Ruby Throat.
Yeah.
And there's a really sharp difference between the sounds of Queen Adrena and Ruby Throat. Was that intentional, or was it just that's the way you guys kind of felt the music needed to go? Or was it like, I'm just tired of this heavy, loud, crazy stuff. Let's do something a little different.
You know, the thing, Crispin and I worked on a song called Pretty Polly, and that was our way into Queen Adrena, and we made demos, and they were all on a Tascam 4-track on tape, and they were these little kind of broken songs, and they just sounded really how they were supposed to be. And then we got in the studio and it just all exploded into this like maelstrom rock monster. And I was so kind of, I was like, actually, this isn't what I intended. But it just grew bigger and bigger and bigger. And anyone that's been in bands for a long time knows that once the monster is rolling, it's really hard to extricate yourself. And, you kind of like lose your brain. And like when, you think, hey, I've got a good thing going here, even though it's destroying me, 10 years later. Man. And then I couldn't drive over bridges. I've been on tour for so long, and I had just so much anxiety of being in tour buses and driving over bridges. It was just like, I really got to the point I was in that weird position in a tiny band that's sort of crawling on three legs, but I'm still paying other people's mortgages and all that kind of thing, and you can't get out of it. Anyway, sorry, I'm getting a bit into it, but
that's okay. That's what the show's all about.
When I heard Chris playing on the London Underground, and the acoustics in those tunnels are beautiful, and I just heard this sound that was the most beautiful guitar I'd ever heard, and I just had to find him, and I was late for somewhere, and I couldn't, I was running down the tunnels, like hearing the sound, and I couldn't find where he was, and I missed him that time. But then I heard it again 2 weeks later, and I was like, he's back, there he is. And I found him, and I went to him, and I still have it as a screenshot in my mind's eye as I went to him, and I just said, excuse me. And he looked up, looked up from under his hat brim, because he plays looking, under his hat, not making any eye contact, and just in his own beautiful world. And it's going to make me cry. oh, God. And I just said, I, you know, I'm a singer. I'd really love to sing with you. just, I'm sorry, it's making me cry.
It's okay. This is so sweet.
And can I have your phone number? And he gave me his phone number, and I called in the next day. And I went and met him, and it just happened that he was, you know, he was literally round the corner from me in the same part of London. And
wow.
I went up into this very strange house with loads of loads of floors. And he had a room, a studio up at the top of the house that looked out onto the most beautiful gardens. And you just don't see that in London. You know, there's no one has an immense garden, but he lived in one of, there's a brand of chocolate in this country called Cadbury's. And he lived in one of the Cadbury's house. He was renting a room in the female Cadbury's house. And oh, okay. She just had these incredible gardens. Anyway, my life changed. It was, you know, that was a meeting, and I saw him, and we talked and we played and we improvised a bit, and everything changed. And it took us a long time, but we made the ventriloquist. We were just friends for a long time.
With your arms around my neck, we ran through the thorny world. The jaw screamed of terror to the world. Daddy was no good. Daddy was no good.
For 5 years, I was still in Queen Adrena. I still drove over bridges, and it was just horrendous. But eventually, I sort of found the exit, and we got together, and we've, you know, been making music ever since. And we sailed around the world ourselves. He's from Hawaii, and he happened to be a sailor, so you know, it's pure magic there. I'm not religious, but I prayed so hard that I'm not religious in the strict sense of organized religion, but I am deeply of meditation and manifestation and all that. And I needed a way. And the day I met him, I'd asked deeper than I'd ever asked for an intervention in my life. And, I found
him. That's not coincidental that you two met then.
No, it's not. And there's more. I won't go on, but he'd kind of seen me at some club a few months before, and his friend had said, "Hey, that one over there with the hat on, she's the one for you." And anyway,
that one over there.
Yeah, that one over there, because we're both like from the family of hats. You know, we both wear hats. So anyway,
so
you know,
definitely meant to be.
Yeah. Yeah.
So the music for Ruby Throat is striking. I mean, it is beautiful, and it's very musically, it's very cinematic almost. I mean, I can hear the music as a soundtrack to a film, as opposed to these individual songs. They seem to flow really, really amazingly well together. And it's like it was written with a theme in mind. And which seems to be, you know, obviously a little bit different from some of the other stuff that you've done, but your performances are just as intense as the bombastic stuff with Daisy Chainsaw and Queen Adrena. I don't know how you do it, because I get exhausted watching it, but exhausted in a good way. It's an amazing intensity that the two of you bring to just on stage, just together. How do you guys do that?
Well, I think, you know, the word you used there was cinematic, and I think that is right. in terms of its scale, because he, you know, Chris, that's where he came from. He's a filmmaker first, and he loves all, I think it's David Lean. He loves all the I think I hope I've quoted that right. The big, really big, gorgeously cinematic movies. That's him. You know, that's his internal landscape. That's what he. That's his story, and you know, the in terms of the intensity, you know, it's just how I got born. You know, I did.
Yeah,
I didn't. The various points, maybe I would have exchanged it, but I've learned, you know, to live with it for better or worse, and you know, it's just what I am. So I think it's but there's also actually there's a flip, because actually I'm really introverted and very happy in my own company, very quiet, and very at peace with my internal landscape. I need it. I spend most of my time there. And I find the outside world an assault on my senses.
I can understand that.
Yeah. So it's, I guess it's the way I am balanced. You know, there's a balance to be found in that, I guess, from the introversion to the apparent extroversion, which isn't, I don't think it is really extroversion, but go on, I let
in the
you
clips,
speak.
In the clips that I've seen, you look like you're being transported, like you basically just left your own body and it's doing its own thing, regardless of what you want it to do. So it's a really, oh gosh, now I'm losing the word. It's a transformative or event. Do you notice? Are you aware of the crowd at that point? And are they as into it as you see, as you get?
I do use the switch, the trigger, you know, the switch I was talking about earlier.
Mm-hmm.
It does create an altered state, and I've learned to let that happen.
Okay.
So it does create an altered state, and I'll sort of flesh this out a bit with the word meditation. I've meditated since I was 18.
Right.
And it's to become no one.
Okay.
To not be. I'm trying to think of it's eternally impossible to explain with words, but simply, you know, it's just like anyone dancing or losing themselves in music, to lose yourself. So I consciously set it up to lose myself.
Are you there? Are you there?
I am here. Do you have me? Did I hit the mute button?
I think maybe.
I did. I think I was getting overly excited.
That's okay. That's all right.
Yeah,
that's what editing's for.
You know
that's
what?
That's one reason why I don't do this live.
I was just talking about losing myself. And there we go. I lost myself, didn't I?
Example.
I turned myself off. Yeah.
Nope. Well, all right. So I have a question for you.
Yeah.
So Ruby Throat is you and Chris.
Yeah.
Liar Flower is also you and Chris. How are the two different?
Okay. Well, we'd, you know, after that not being able to drive over bridges, I just couldn't hear drums anymore.
Oh, okay.
I just couldn't. I couldn't have that dictate the rhythm of me. I had to get some sense of being holding the wheel again myself. Mm-hmm. And so for maybe 8-9 years, we didn't really have drums of any real kind. Maybe there was a couple of things. Dog Song, I think, has some kind of rhythmic element to it. So we didn't do that. And then coming back from the sea from our second circumnavigation with our baby girl and Chris's boy, Dylan, who's now 18. We were on the land and we had some walls around us and we could make a noise. And it just seemed time to start making a noise again. And that coincided with a sort of introducing Ruby Throat record we did last year through One Little India, because we'd made lots of records, but we felt like no one had really heard them.
I married your dog on his knees on this tree. I wanna say he got down on his knees. All that was gathered a day for the friends.
So we did a sort of introducing, taking our favourite songs from Ruby Throat and doing an album called Stone Dress. But then I'd left off what I suddenly thought was some key songs, and we put those on a CD and stuck them on the vinyl and called that little EP Liar Flower. And I'd found that those words in one of my writing books, and they just became louder and louder and louder. And I said to Chris, I think we've got to go with this. We need to move into this new identity, into this new person.
Okay.
Or this new perspective, just a slight slant on it. And it just felt really good to be Liar Flower. And that took us down a new road of improvising through the meditation stream of consciousness that I was writing, and Chris plugging in, playing electric guitar, which he hadn't been able to do for such a long time, and we improvised together. And some of those songs, like Mud Stars and My Brain Is Lit Like an Airport, they are actual improvisations.
My brain is lit like an airport, so the angels will find me.
Oh, wow.
That, you know, that thing where you can, once you're steeped in your craft, that you can let go and improvise and the song comes out. And he's a good editor. He's from filmmaking background and he can really find the story in there. So those songs are the slightly messed around with edited version of actual improvisations. And I'm gratified, you know, we got that. We finally made that, we're able to make that happen.
Well,
which is kind of a lifelong destination, really. I've always wanted to be able to capture the first thing and have that be the real thing, the recording.
Well, it's amazing. That song in particular, My Brain Is Lit Like an Airport, that I love that track, but you do a lot of really interesting sequencing. Like the album is sequenced really interestingly. Like Broken Light is, followed by Even Though the Darkest Clouds, and then to Bloodberry. So you're going like soft to something pretty hard, then back to something nice and soft and light again. It really highlights the stark difference between a lot of the songs.
Mm-hmm.
It's amazing. And then you have Little Brown Shoe.
Yeah.
Which
that's improvised. Actually, was that one? That was actually, we worked that out a bit, but there is, that is mainly, that is, yeah, no, actually we did, we wrote some of that before we improvised, but it, you know, it's a live, anyway, they're all live recordings. So.
Okay. So there's a lot of improvisation as you're recording, even if it's something you've already worked on.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. Yeah. With something like Little Brown Shoe. Yeah.
Now that one sounds like there's some humor to
it. Oh, yeah. Thank God.
I kind of like that. So does humor play much into the music? Because a lot of it can be pretty intense. And if there is a humor, it's maybe not obvious. Does that play a part in your songwriting?
I think, yeah. You know, I guess I don't get, I guess so. I guess it's not very apparent. But, you know, in the end, it's all just a bit of, it's just a bit of fun, isn't it?
Yeah. So I do have another question, though, before we start to wind everything down. I know I've kept you for a while. You and Chris did go back out and live on a small sailboat, mm-hmm. raising your daughter
yeah.
and spending some years at sea. Why did you make that choice? I know you spent several years as a child out on sea, and then was it just like it was such a great experience for you that you wanted to do that with Chris and your daughter?
Yeah. Yeah, we had an extraordinary event. We were living on a canal boat in London, and we had an extraordinary sort of family event, which I won't go into the details of it, but we just went, okay, we're gonna do this, and we're gonna do this now. We have the means. We bought a boat on the internet. And I was heavily pregnant, and Chris went and collected and sailed the boat back from Gibraltar.
Wow.
We spent a year fitting out the boat, and we left.
Oh, my God.
And we left, and we spent 4 years sailing around the world. 4 years is you know, more time to spend in the beautiful places. And it was... Yes, Layli had. She grew. She was one year old when we left.
Oh my gosh!
And it was. It's everything doing that. It's real life. That's the thing that we love about it. Is you? You know, it's so elemental, and it brings you so firmly into your body, and. I keep wanting to avoid what I'm going to say, but it literally it cuts the crap, you know, it literally does. And even the canal boat was like that. It's very elemental life. The first night on the canal boat, we woke up with, you know, ice on the inside of the windows. And but I do feel that that's the right way. You know, I fear that human, certainly, actually, I would never put anything on anyone else, but for us, you need grist to the mill. You need to have a physical wrestling match rather than a mental wrestling match.
Okay.
It puts things into the right order for me.
Okay.
And stops the mind being dominant. And running away with itself and getting overly excited and overly obsessed and overly anxious and all that kind of thing.
Oh, okay.
If you're working the body, if you do what the body, you know, use your body in a very physical survival way, there's the mind settles, you know, and it doesn't eat the body.
That's, you know what, that's an excellent point. I didn't think about that. So that kind of brings me to the next question I've got for you. Does the sea play an influence in the song? I mean, the isolation of being at the sea, I'm sure does, but you could have moved to a, you know, a farm and been just as isolated.
Yeah.
Does the sea play an influence in your music, vocally and musically?
Yeah.
Lyrically, I guess.
Absolutely. And you know, it's where I'm at peace. And I need it. I need it. And I need to immerse in it. I need to get in it every day. I need that. I need it. And I need white noise. I need that noise. I really do. I find that just puts me into such a state of bliss. And I, you know, I found that on air conditioning units way before I actually was aware of what it was, or certain fans in certain bathrooms, you know, that kind of, just that sound that I need that certain frequency. And I am of the sea. I am of the sea. And it's always, we're just waiting now to our boats waiting for us round the corner. We return to the sea. We go back this year. We go back to the sea.
Oh, wonderful. Wonderful. And I wanted to say, you know, that watching the videos and the visual imagery that goes along with the music is amazing. Chris is just incredibly talented at what he does.
He is, isn't he?
And each of Ruby Throat's releases have had some kind of handcrafted packaging and artwork, some exclusive things, and some limited edition runs of physical copies of each album. Is that kind of bespoke approach going to continue with Liar Flower?
Yeah, it is. You know, we're in the time that we're in, and that meant the factory that we are, it's a like a little local printing shop that we use, that was all shut down as well. And that's why we wanted to release this record. We knew the records for now, and we that's why I went back to One Little Indian and to Derek, because they have access to so they're helping us with it, to make a limited edition. It'd be a double vinyl one.
Oh, wow.
So it's got a couple of extra songs on it as well, of the Liar Flower Geiger Counter record. So we're doing that with them, and we are going to do some actual limited edition packages that we just hand make ourselves at home of this record as well.
Oh, cool.
So we will do that. And then I think we'll get to work on the next record and carry on with our, you know, our DIY cottage boat industry, where we sell it to our beloved people that are our supporters and patrons that keep us being able to do what we do year after year. You know, we're incredibly fortunate to be able to do, to be self, touch wood, sufficient musicians doing, you know, making what we love and having people, literally, you know, it's like the old fashioned way of hundreds of years ago, you know, a patron of the arts. These days it's scattered among hundreds of people rather than just one benefactor. And it's, without the internet, you know, we could never have done this. And so we're eternally grateful for everything that we have and everything that we can. It gives us such a artistic freedom and such a physical freedom as well. Albeit living very, very, very frugally, but we're good for that. And I like that. You know, it literally keeps me hungry. I've always been hungry, and I know that's instrumental in my work. So being hungry.
Yeah, it's definitely fuel for the creative side of you, for sure.
Yeah, it is, yeah.
So the album closes, at least the version that I have, I don't don't know about the extra stuff that's coming with the vinyl, but the album version that I have closes with Doors Locked, Ovens Off.
Yeah.
That is beautiful. It's a beautiful instrumental, and it's possibly one of my favorite titles ever. Is that both of you playing, or is that just Chris?
Oh, no, that's just Chris. That's Chris left to his own devices.
It's absolutely beautiful.
It is beautiful, isn't it? And he, you know, you could probably listen to an hour of that, but he, you know, he did a really hard edit on it.
Oh, wow. Okay. Because I could have listened to that for probably an hour without even realizing it.
I'll get him to send you a long version of it.
Oh, that would be amazing. Well, now, how can people find the album? When is it coming out? How do they order it? And how do they follow you on social media? And are you going to be able to post and to keep people up on what you're doing even when you're out to sea? Or are you going to cut off completely?
Well, we always, we get, wherever we get, you know, there's, you got this World Wide Web thing going on, so you can go and find it, you know. It even,
that crazy internet.
And it is crazy, you know, in the most remote spots on Earth, there it is, there's the tiny, the tiny, you know, little dusty table, and there's an internet connection there on a desert island with three people.
Unbelievable.
It, you know, so there it is, for better or for worse. So I'm, well, my website is katiejanegarside.com. That sort of serves up as a sort of hub for all the stuff that we, you know, we sort of in a sort of quite a chaotic way try and sort of keep a handle on.
Okay.
And then I do take part a little bit on Instagram, and that's, I think, my thing there is Garside KatieJane on there. And I believe this record is out on the 1st of May. You can already go to the One Little Indian website and download it now and buy the limited edition vinyl, which will be ready in a little while. And I think there's 500 copies of that, so I think that's that.
You better jump on it.
Yeah.
Well, thank you guys so much for spending so much time with me. It's been a really it's been a blast talking to you and getting to know a little bit about your history and what got you to where you are now. And I'm honestly fascinated by the whole spending a year at sea. My wife and I have actually talked about something like that. Not as extreme as sailing around the world. We were just thinking, like, you know, houseboat on the Gulf of Mexico kind of thing. But
do it, but, do it, do it. Yeah,
I don't have the sailing chops that you guys do.
Well, a lot of people don't, you know, when they start out, and quite often the most dangerous bit about sailing is the land. So you get on your boat and you start and you head out to sea, and then you can figure it out. as long as you've got nothing to hit, you know, as long as that's the main thing. And you keep, and you know, keep your feet clear of the lines. That's
okay.
That's the other bit of advice. But yeah, no, houseboat Mexico, do it. It's so gorgeous. You don't need to learn to sail. Canal boat in London is just such a beautiful way to live. And, you know, you can feed the swans in the morning. They'll come up to your little window and all that kind of, it's beautiful. Do it, do it, do it.
All right. I'm going to mention it to my wife, because we've kind of thrown that about for, well, actually ever since we got married almost 20 years ago. And it's been something we've thrown about. Yeah, we should do it. No, I don't know.
You will not look back. You will not look back. You will not. You should do that.